Hey, follow that truck. They know the best places to stop.
That's an old maid's tale.
Bullshit.
Truck drivers are the only ones that know the best places to stop on the road.
Salesmen and cops are the ones. If he'd have a waitress, honey, he'd know that.
Don't call me honey, Mac.
Don't call me Mac, honey.
Hey everybody, and welcome back to What the Hell Happened to Them? Jack Attacks the Cast. That's right, Jack Nicholson this season. It's been a while, but we're back. And joining me on the line is a sadistic sailor, Joe Vekeman.
Arr.
You're not a pirate, Joe. You're just
in the
Navy.
But I'm sadistic. So I'm Ensign Pulver?
You're Ensign Pulver, yeah. And on the audio boards is Lev Van Rensselaer, reminding me to remind you that you can email the cast of What Happened to Them cast at gmail.com. And our sponsor this week is the Jig Mac. McDonald's with its new dance-inducing treat, the Jig Mac. All right, Joe, what movie are we doing this week?
I don't even want to say it. It sounds almost like a slur. I don't like that at all. We watched Five Easy Pieces.
The movie that makes us ask, what if Henrik Ibsen wrote Good Will Hunting? Is that a reference you get?
No. Did you not like the movie?
Well, Joe, why don't you describe the movie and we'll go into it.
I'll describe the movie as, I loved it. It's such a nice warm blanket over me. So, a dropout from upper class America picks up work along the way on oil rigs when his life isn't spent in a squalid succession of bars, motels, and other points of interest.
Yeah, that's not the best summary.
Yeah, it's fine.
That does summarize the first chapter of the film, I guess we'd call it, and not even very well. It really just is like, here, who's this character?
Yeah, but you're so right. I would divide this movie up into chapters.
Yes, it's a chapter film, and that's not a bad thing.
This was nominated for 4 Oscars. Did you know that?
I did. Mm-hmm.
Oh.
But the audience might not. Why don't you go on?
Best Picture. Best Actor in a Leading Role. Jack Nicholson. Best Actress in a Supporting Role. Karen Black, who's so good in this. And Best Writing, Story and Screenplay based on factual material or previously not published or produced. So that's original screenplay, right?
You said not based on factual material, right?
Story and screenplay. Oh, no. But wait, it says story and screenplay based on factual material or material not previously published or produced.
Is this a book? Like, what? What about this is factual?
Well, that's a weird way to write that, right? That's just...
Oh, the Academy overcomplicating things? Oh, no. They would never do that.
I'm going to say that is... the best original screenplay nomination. That's what I'm going to go with. If they want to argue with me and tell me what it is, argue.
Yeah, I don't think anyone's going to argue with you at this point.
Wasn't it great seeing Lois Smith as his sister? Do you like Lois Smith? She just pops up in a lot of things.
Yeah, I don't know who she is.
She played Partita Dupia.
Yeah, okay. Let me rephrase. I don't know what else she's done.
She's got a good scene in Minority Report that I'm remembering right now. She's in Lady Bird. She's in The Nice Guys. She's in The French Dispatch.
Seems like she just kept on working.
She's been on Mom, the show that I know you've watched,
right? I have watched, yep.
She was on an episode of Just Shoot Me. Oh my God, she's coming back up. We're going to watch her on The Pledge. Do you remember The Pledge?
Nope, I don't think I've seen or heard of this movie.
A Jack Nicholson movie from 2001. I believe directed by Sean Penn.
Oh, I see. When you said it's coming up, I assumed you meant in the next 2 or 3 movies we would be watching The Pledge.
I meant by the end of next year. okay, she was in Midnight Run, Fatal Attraction. I mean, she's just a working actress. I liked her. I was happy to see her.
Like Psych Out, this was another movie that when I watched it for the first time in that Jack Nicholson retrospective, like 5 years ago yes. now, I was not very kind to it, and I was not... I was not talking with the movie in the language it wanted to, and that was on me as I was putting this structure that was trained into me onto it, and that's not what the movie wanted to do anyway. And it was sort of what the movie was rebelling against at the time when America was rebelling against itself. Coming in it now with different eyes and wanting different things out of my movies, but understanding how the cinematic grammar works a lot better now, I say, this is a dynamite movie. I think the movie...
Hell fucking yeah.
Yeah, the movie's really good. I can so see the movie running into trouble, though, with the character that can be difficult for a modern audience to grok or care about in a world where our morality is so calcified into right and wrong, we just might not give this character the time of day and just kind of instantly judge him and not realize sort of the nuance that's going on with all the characters here, pretty much, except the fancy piano lady. Forget her name.
Is it Catherine?
The older brothers... love interest, wife, yeah. Fiance.
I think they were getting married.
Yeah, they're getting married. So other than that, the characters here are nuanced, but also it's like a disregard or like a closing off of what was wrong with America at that time period and the listlessness that a lot of people felt and kind of the violent rebelliousness. I guess the way to describe it is what you have here is basically a man who's searching, but not in kind of a Zen Buddhist way. He's just searching, and since he'll never find the answer that he's looking for, he's kind of doomed to wander in this anger at what either he's perceived to deserve or what he's hoping is out there. And I think a lot of Americans were going through that and could find themselves in him. Maybe they can't now, or they don't want to admit to it now, or they need to have this, I don't know, gallant morality placed onto any actions that they do today because of these stupid Marvel films, that it becomes harder to talk with a movie like this. Does any of that make sense?
Yeah. No, okay. Yeah, no.
I said I went on an odd rant there.
No, I enjoyed it. I agree completely. I hadn't seen this movie since I got the box set, and I watched Head and this movie like right away, and then I just never went back and finished the box set. I'm doing it right now.
The Five Easy Pieces makes sense because that's a really famous one. Head's an interesting one. I don't think most people have heard of Head.
I think I just like start. Those were the first two that were in the set. I think like the back to back, right?
Yeah, you know what?
But
you
I think
might
maybe
right.
I skipped over Easy Rider.
Oh, yes.
I don't know why I skipped over Easy Rider. It was so weird that I skipped
over Easy Rider and Five Easy Pieces would make sense to start with. And then I think the famous one after that is maybe King of Marvin Gardens, maybe Last Picture Show. It's one of those two.
Probably Last Picture Show now, just because I feel like there's been like...
a Bogdanovich resurgence.
Yes, absolutely. Especially since he passed away earlier this year. I don't know what it was about this movie. I even wanted to figure out how to say the woman's name correctly. The songs that keep coming up by Tammy Wynette.
Yep.
Right? Did I say that right? Wynette? Okay. It colors this movie in such a beautiful way. Just like a sad melancholy just kind of hangs over the movie. I was just vibing with it so hard. I was just like, this is incredible. When he's stuck in traffic and he's just like screaming and I'm like, if I could just be as like interesting to just be like, you know what? I'm going to get out in the middle of this traffic and find something like that when he gets onto the truck with a piano. And she's like, this is the rest of my day. I'm just going to head over with this guy on this truck and wherever he takes me, that's where I'm going to go. I'm going to wander around town and just, you know, screw work that day. What a life. Just to be able to say, fuck it.
What a life. Yes, this is sort of... America wasn't great. Like, even Easy Rider is more of a thematic piece than a character study. Mm-hmm. Americans weren't super interested in making these kinds of films that had been popular over in Europe and Asia for quite a bit. That particular traffic scene He, like, barks at a dog at one point in the middle of it, and that reminds me of that, geez, who's that woman that made Fish Tank?
Andrea Arnold.
Yes. So she's got a short film that ends with this, I won't give it all away, because it's a good one, but at the end of it, she just kind of, like, starts barking at her mother, like a dog, like a rabid dog, and you're like, well, like, they're just expressing this kind of anger and frustration. I wonder if this was an influence, but I think what is interesting here is the information that we get over time. Like, the Tammy Wynette songs are interesting when we learn that he's actually a classically trained musician. And he seems to both despise his background and look down on other people who don't have it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm interested in this character who grew up well-bred in a certain music tradition, and then he hears this kind of, you know, country western song, and that's his day-to-day life now, and how does he feel about that song, about that music? He certainly looks down on his girlfriend.
God,
the best character in the whole movie.
Yeah, he just takes a dump on her.
But he's also oddly defensive of her, too, when other people look down on her, which is what makes it interesting. And those first two scenes, like the first scene, there's a brief glimmer of him being like, oh, you're here? Damn it. But then, like, they seem to, like, you know, be smiling and happy and having a good time. And at that bowling alley, there's a lot of undulations in their relationship, too.
That is a perfect, like, little, like, short film right there.
And that's the movie's really a bunch of non sequiturs with this kind of familial through line that eats up the last chapter, the last third of the film.
Mm-hmm.
The movie went a lot faster this time than I was expected. You know, they're like, it's like 100 minutes.
Like 90 minutes. Yeah.
And then it's 100 minutes. It's 98 minutes. And it just ended a lot quicker than I thought. Especially since the credits are like 4 seconds long. So it's really just wall-to-wall movie.
It's just the main actor's credits. That's it.
Yeah, and it sneaks up on you. And you're like, oh my God, I've already done. That was so quick. Surprising me because I didn't like the movie the first time. So I'm like, all right, well, we got to get through this one. But when you're open-minded and you realize, like, the non-sequiturness of it is kind of has this the tone of this roaming, like this guy is just kind of wandering from place to place, like that non-sequitur structure works. These kooky characters that are in there, like the sister you brought up, Partiti, I think they just call her T.
Yeah.
She's like, I don't know, there's like a weird, it's almost like she kind of never grew up, like she never kind of fully made it out of her father's shadow, and so she's in a weird spot where she has to now, realizing that her father's at the end, that she has to kind of start. We're watching her kind of grow out of adulthood, but she's in her 30s, and so like that's kind of a weird mentality. She has this kind of odd posture. The brother does a weird walk.
Yeah, they
put this neck brace around
it.
Him, which gives him an odd physicality, too. He could have been a really boring character, but they did a lot of physical things with him. These two hitchhikers that he picks up,
yeah,
they themselves together are an interesting character. You have this, I think that they're lesbians, but she, the leader of the two is just won't shut up. And the other woman is just bored at Tony Basil that we've seen a few times already.
Yeah.
Bored out of her mind. They're like, okay, we're doing this again. And we don't even really get to see Jack's reaction to it. It's really just, we see the girlfriend, I presume, being bored, and then Karen Black being a little interested at the beginning, and then immediately, like, she's trying to engage, and the woman's like, what the F are you talking about? That's not at all what's going on here. But I think that's why I like the Karen Black character, is she's the only one that's, like, sincere in the whole film. There's no irony in her. There's no sarcasm. She just thinks everybody is like her, putting themselves out there. And she gets nothing for it. It's so depressing.
Yeah, so Karen Black has shown up in a few movies I've watched this year, because she's in a couple of Altman movies.
Yeah, she was working pretty steadily after this, pretty nonstop.
She has kind of a similar role in Nashville, where she's just kind of the, maybe taken for granted, like, wife, and she's just like, she thinks she can't, they make her not sing in that movie, like they say that she can't sing at all, and in this movie she sings so beautifully, and I'm like, oh, I had no idea she could sing. Like, when you watch Nashville, you're like, this woman can't sing for shit. And then the fact that they're able to have her not sing when she can sing so beautifully is just something else. But she was in The Player, so we've had a crossover
she
already.
She was in The Player as herself, and I went,
yes,
where, how did I, was she just, like, in the background somewhere? Did she even have a line?
Yeah, I've grown to really appreciate her. She's She's kind of a one-of-a-kind actress.
Yeah, sadly, I was kind of going through her Wikipedia filmography, and there was a surprising amount of work that didn't even link to another page, and I go, that probably doesn't bode well. No, but the director wrote once, somewhere I saw it, that Karen Black was able to work pretty much all the time afterwards because she was not very choosy with her roles. So yeah, she did end up getting a lot of the same role, which is what happens when you get Academy Award nominated out of nowhere. Whereas the other woman, the fancy one, she was a lot more choosier. And so a lot of people wanted her to be the same type of character. And she was like, no. And so she didn't really work. She did work a fair amount, but didn't work super duper much. I think she was in Cagney and Lacey. She was so choosy, but somehow.
Okay, are you talking about Catherine?
Yeah.
I got breaking news. I got breaking news. Because I bet you don't even know this. Susan Anspach, who played Catherine, was in Blood Red.
I did know that, Joe. I was about to get there.
Okay, sorry.
I'm like, she's so choosy and still ended up in Blood Red. Famous cinematic Julia Gemstone film, Blood Red.
That's very funny. I'm also seeing here, because I was wondering who Carl was in this movie. I was like, I've seen that actor a million times before. That's Ralph Waite. He is John Walton in The Waltons.
That's true.
One of my grandma's favorite shows to watch.
It's ever. Most grandparents' favorite shows, yeah.
Very, like, heavy grandparent favorite. I also thought the actor who played the father, his name's William Challey. I just thought he was really good. Just very, had to be very stoic because he's had a couple strokes, they said. Just playing, like, the little ticks very well. Wow, he's been in so many things.
Yeah, a lot of character actors in these BBS productions to keep the budget down. Makes sense.
Yeah.
But there's no slouches in here. No one's doing a bad job.
I really appreciate your input on this. I'm glad you liked it this time. I had a blast.
I could just see a lot of people today, especially our age, just being like, this guy sucks. I don't like him. This movie's bad. And I think that's the wrong way to approach it. Especially since I don't think you have to like your characters. I just don't know how you don't find him interesting if you're not there trying to sit in moral superiority of him. He's interesting, she's interesting, the family dynamic. Like, even the older brother, who ostensibly seems like he's the only one being nice to Karen Black in the dinner scene when she invites herself over. You can kind of feel there's a condescension there. Like, he's being nice to her because he thinks, well, you can't take care of yourself. You're an idiot. You need a strong man to kind of help you because you are just so naive and dumb.
Did you watch any special features on the disc?
I did them all, Joe. I told you.
Okay. Excellent. So I'm going to read you a quote from our good friend, Raj.
Roger. Roger. R-O-G-E-R.
All right. What does Roger Ebert have to say?
He said, it is difficult to explain today how much Bobby Tupia meant to the film's first audiences. I was at the New York Film Festival for the premiere of Five Easy Pieces, and I remember the explosive laughter, the deep silences, the stunned attention as the final shot seemed to continue forever. And then the ovation. We'd had a revelation. This was the direction American movies should take. Into idiosyncratic characters, into dialogue with an ear for the vulgar and the literate. Into a plot free to surprise us about the characters. Into an existential ending not required to be happy. Five Easy Pieces was a fusion of the personal cinema of John Cassavetes and the new indie movement that was tentatively emerging.
Yeah, I think that the phrase there, plot free to surprise us, is very important and is what gets left behind a lot in the Hollywood sabermetrics approach to filmmaking. Black Adam could really only go one way, you know? And that kind of sucks. And even the Julia Roberts movie can really only go one way. Like, that's just the...
Yeah.
And, you know, it seems to give people what they want, but there's also something worrisome here where, if I may get tinfoil hat theory here for a bit...
Oh, okay.
A lot of societies run into trouble when they limit the realm of perceivable thoughts in its population. This is what's called the doxa. These are the things that a society deem are worthy of brain space and the ability to conceive. And so if we're, you know, whether on purpose or just as an economic reality, pushing movies that do not expand what a doxa is, ultimately they're going to shrink due to atrophy. And so if we're limiting the thoughts that can come up during a movie and the introspection we can have and the domain of what a life can be and could be, then a society is sort of hurtling towards an inevitable end that will have to kind of start to rebuild itself at some point anyway. So there's a danger here, okay, if we only kind of keep pushing one type of movie, because we're going to have a harder time thinking, is sort of the shorthand of what I just said. And I think thinking less is bad. That's my hot take. We should think more.
I was going to say, what you were saying was very bleak.
Yes.
But then at the end, you were like, but we can rebuild. And I'm like, well, there's some hope.
Yeah, I know, but like, we shouldn't have there. To hurtle into, we shouldn't have to implode to get to the good stuff. We should be like, huh, maybe we should be promoting something more.
Of course, yes.
Even as our nation is sort of focusing on more progressive things, we're doing it in suspiciously simplistic terms. It kind of worries me for what happens after that battle's won. What stage have we set for the next struggle that we should try to be preparing for now to save us trouble later on? Now it's less calcified, and it might even make the battle that we're trying to move for easier if we had an expanded doxa. That doesn't feel unreasonable to me.
But I also want to point out, it's probably one of the first times you've been optimistic on this podcast.
I'm a very optimistic person. I have a lot of anger because I'm watching it all go down the tubes. But I'm angry because I know we can do better. If I were really cynical, I'd be like, well, we're all just fucked. And I'm like, no, it's in us to improve. The tools are here. We are currently capable of the thought processes needed to change it and to improve it, to turn it around, and to have love in ourselves. But we are just, every day feels like we're choosing not to, and I don't know why. So I'm confused a lot. And that makes me angry, as it would most people.
I agree.
Okay.
I'm on your side.
That's not movie related. Sally Struthers in this movie.
It
says introducing Sally Struthers, and I go, oh, it's kind of funny, because probably by the time this movie's released, All in the Family has aired on TV.
Yeah. Because this came out in 1970.
It came out in 70. It was shot, obviously, before she was cast on All in the Family.
Yes.
Now, All in the Family had three pilots, and I think she was only in the last one. Like, they kept recasting it. I think they got Archie Bunker and maybe Edith pretty early on in the first one, and then the second one they got what's the director's name? Rob?
Oh, this director? Bob Rafelson.
No. The director who does Harry Met Sally. Rob Reiner.
Rob Reiner.
They get Rob Reiner and his mic, and then in the last one they cement Gloria in there. So I've seen all three pilots because they're in the box set that I have of All in the Family. Well, real quick, Sally Struthers has this monologue, this mini monologue about how awful her mother was to her, but she doesn't view it that way. And everybody just kind of ignores it. Like, you have a, it's this thematic thing that feels like it doesn't, you know, I could see a modern executive being like, well, this scene doesn't really do anything. Let's cut it. It's bad for the rhythm or whatever random thing they would say. But that's, it's sort of showing us people unable to express themselves or to be, or like even in a moment when they can find that vulnerability, they get nothing out of it. And so they're discouraged from ever having that again. And it just becomes these very casual or surface level relationships in any kind of capacity, romantic, sexual, friendly. Like, it's all just there to fill time, it feels like, more than to be meaningful. And even in a moment where Jack Nicholson is trying to get his crush to like him back, even in that moment, when she is there, impressed by what he is, and finally willing to give him the time of day, he refuses to be vulnerable in that moment and to take the treat that she's given her. And he's still just sarcastic and irony and ironic and trying to push her away. And she's like, what the fuck, you dude? I'm being sincere here. What is your problem? And he's like, what's your problem?
He's always got that shield up. You can't put it down.
That that earlier dimples scene with Sally Struthers that somebody could be like, we don't need that, is out of importance for informing a lot of the theme of this character. And that's kind of what frustrates me. Like, everything, all the weird random crap feels organic and feels like it belongs. The one weird thing that I go, it feels a little contrived, is she's mad at him for that. Then they start yelling at each other. And then she's like, okay, yeah, you can forcibly make out with me and then we'll have sex. And I go, I don't know if I buy this part of the whole thing. Maybe if something else happened in between, I could get on board. I don't see what this is. And it ends basically just as quickly. Everything else felt very organic and necessary. I guess you need him to get sort of thrown away. He needs to go through the Karen Black experience, basically, in this movie. He needs to be treated the way that he treats her, Karen Black. In a way, you would think, like, this is his opportunity to redeem himself. The fact that he doesn't, obviously, is sort of a strong statement. But I think to get to that point, I think they got a little contrived, and I think that's the kind of the one weaker part of the movie. But I could be wrong, and you could tell me why. What happened to them, cast@gmail.com, and I'm always interested in thoughts on this film.
I just want to point out, in that scene before they do that, it's like they're wrestling each other. They're like holding each other, like circling the room, and you're just like,
some of the blocking there is not the best either. It feels a little soap operatic, and the movie was largely been able to ignore that. It is a sadly weak scene, but outside of that, the movie's pretty good.
Five Easy Pieces refers to a book of piano lessons for beginners.
So is that why it's an adapted screenplay, do you think?
Do you really think so?
The way you describe the category, it sounds like it's an adapted screenplay.
I was saying it to you verbatim, what I was like, I wasn't putting in like crazy words in there. That's how it is written.
Yeah, that's the legit thing.
Yeah. Jack Nicholson wrote some of his own lines for the monologue Bobby says to his father. I liked how it was a little like cyclical, where they have the big traffic jam at the beginning and he's like all angry, and then he's causing a traffic jam just to talk to Catherine at the end.
Yeah.
And everyone's just like, come on, hurry up.
Yeah, there's like, that.
I'm trying to talk.
We see his wandering kind of begin and end.
And then I got this little anecdote. The moment at the end of the diner scene where Bobby sweeps all the glasses off the table after arguing with the waitresses was inspired by Jack Nicholson actually doing this himself once at a coffee shop called Poopies up on the Strip. When the man in a dress took his coffee away despite him only having just arrived because the group of fellow actors he joined had been there for hours and were being told to leave.
What a wild time the 70s was. Could you imagine in the year of our Lord 2022 eating at a place called Poopies?
Thank you. Did you watch the video? You watched the interview. He comes in for that one like anecdote. And I'm like, this is what they got from him.
The name of the restaurant didn't register with me at the time, I guess, but Poopies. Good Lord.
He's got two little like it's a 9-minute like feature, and he's got like one little like tiny story, and like that's the story they went with where he talks about this restaurant called Poopies.
I could just see in his head he's probably like, Poopy.
Well, he's like a 70-something-year-old man. That was done in 2009.
He can find anything funny now. Like, he doesn't have anything to prove anymore.
Yeah, he's basically retired. He's just about to hang it up with... God, what is his fucking name? Brooks.
Mel Brooks.
No.
James L. Brooks.
Thank you. How do you know? He's just about to film How Do You Know? But he's like, I've got one interview for this Criterion Collection... All right, I'll sit down.
They seem to have done all the interviews for this entire box set in one go, because he's always in the same hotel room. So they were like, can we have an hour of your time, and we'll stretch it out as best we can in the special features? And he's like, all right, as long as the Lakers aren't on, we're good.
We'll do it at like 10 a.m. in the morning.
There's a guy who looks like a burly Andy Kaufman in this film that's taking care of the father.
Oh, yeah. He's like the nurse. Yeah. And like his sister.
Yeah, his sister this is sort of the adolescent part of her. She's like, what do you think of this guy? He's kind of a weird looking guy, isn't he? But maybe some people would find him attractive. And you're like, well, that's definitely the way a 13-year-old would think. Like, that's what we...
Yeah, they're not even doing anything. She's getting, like, a back massage from him. Like, it's not, like, anything, like, crazy.
The movie's not passing judgment. And if you were at all confused by that, I think it's important that Jack Nicholson finally gets his ass kicked at some point after starting all these fights and yelling at people. That he tries to pick a fight with angry Andy Kaufman, and he just gets owned.
Immediately, he gets put in a headlock, and he's like... Stop. You want to stop? You want to stop? You want to stop? And he's like,
are we done,
no!
Jack? Are we done? Is it over?
And he just, like, he keeps picking up his head in the headlock, and then he just finally drops him, and Jack just falls to the ground like a pile of potatoes. It's just really funny.
Yeah, like, the movie's not saying this is a bad thing. It's not saying this is a good thing. It's just like, this is a thing. Here it is. You do what you want with it. And this level of laissez-faire in films, we didn't do very well back then, and we certainly don't do it at all now. And I think that is a problem. That's kind of a propaganda machine that we have now. That's part of this constricted doxa that I'm always worried about. There's some editing issues, too. The group scenes seem to throw off Bob, the director, Bob Rafelson, and the editors. They get away with it mostly, but some things just certainly don't feel as clean as the rest of their dialogue scenes and other stuff going on. That might have been a budget thing. They might not have gotten the coverage that they needed, or, you know, it's his second film, so he just might have a harder time seeing how things are going to cut together. He gets away with it most of the time, but there are some things that stand out noticeably more than some of the other problems. The redhead trailer park friend of theirs, her name is Stoney. Jack Nicholson's character from Psych Out, you say? Perhaps.
Oh.
Perhaps.
Did you hear me, though, before? Did you have any audio issues at the beginning of the movie?
No.
Just like when they're entering his house, it's on my Blu-ray, it sounded like really quiet, like when he was trying to talk to Karen Black's character in the other room.
It could be. So if that's, I believe, was a handheld shot. I think it's like a big one-shot thing, if I remember. And
yeah.
The mic just might have had a hard time getting where it needed to be. There's also a chance that they might not wanted us to fully hear it.
That's true.
Godard did that a few times. He usually does it with the score. He has the score come up. It doesn't always help when you don't speak French, because now you have subtitles and you're hearing it anyway. But the subtitler might not have realized there was an intent behind the loud music and random parts of the dialogue. But I don't know. I don't remember being bothered or... I don't remember being like, huh, I can't hear this. Like, Easy Rider, I'm like, oh, there's a lot of bad audio here.
It was, I don't know if it was just like, it seemed like it was dulled, like dulled down. I was like,
it could have been a choice.
Yeah, it could be. I think I'm going to go with it was a choice.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think it affects too much whether it was or wasn't. Didn't take me out of it. I was fine.
I got one more thing. Okay, so Jack Nicholson's wardrobe consisted largely of Bob Rafelson's own clothes. I just thought that was funny.
And his wife was the production designer. Like, they have to, you got to cut costs however you can.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to look up the budget in a second. Ellen Burstyn was considered for the role of Rayette, Karen Black's character.
Oh, you mean Exorcist star Ellen Burstyn?
This is also, like, what, a year or two before she was in Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore? You've seen that movie, right?
I've seen the movie, yeah.
Okay, good.
Well, she's about to pop off. She's in one of these other BBS films, isn't she? Is she in King of Marvin Gardens?
So I thought she was in Last Picture Show, but I'm probably totally wrong.
I mean, they're pretty much back-to-back, so I wouldn't be surprised if I confused them.
She's in The Last Picture Show. I watched it this year. Very good, like, great movie. She is in The King of Marvin's Gardens.
Ah, okay. She's just part of the BBS team, then. There you go.
Yeah, she... Wow, Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore was in 74. I thought that was 72 for some reason.
Hey, it's a good decade for films.
Yeah, I'm glad she didn't get, though. Karen, this was... I don't think she would have worked as well as Karen Black. I think this was, like, kind of the Karen Black role.
Yeah, I agree. All the actors here pretty stand out. I wish we could have snuck in Millie Perkins into one of these roles, but it's fine.
She could have been one of the hitchhikers, maybe.
She could have been a hitchhiker. She could have been, I don't know, Catherine, the boring lady.
Oh, yeah.
Well, surprise, surprise, movie does not pass the Bechdel test. In 1970.
Ooh.
Shocked. I'm shocked.
Surprise, surprise.
You want to sneak in a little Watergate watch here?
Hell yeah. Bring it on.
Watergate, Watergate, oh, water, 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 Watergate.
Watch.
So we had gone through all of the Wikipedia listed Watergate films, but since I began, they actually added one that I just noticed. Because over the summer, Netflix came out with a documentary, The Martha Mitchell Effect.
Weird timing, because that would have been right after the Julia Roberts series.
Well, I think that was part of the plan.
Wow.
Is my guess. It's only 40 minutes, and it's your typical kind of documentaries. You got talking heads, though you don't see any of them. But you've also got a lot of news broadcasts narrating things, and even Watergate tapes. They're not Watergate tapes, but the Nixon White House tapes explaining things. They even had a clip from the Frost-Nixon interviews where Nixon's like, yeah, if it weren't for Martha Mitchell, there wouldn't have been a Watergate. And you're like, wow, that's a strong take. and watching the real Martha Mitchell talk and do her thing, Julia nailed that impression pretty good.
Oh, good.
She had it there, and she got a little tummy to her, the real Martha Mitchell, and you're like, oh, in Gaslit, they kind of gave her that. She didn't look like Hollywood star Julia Roberts anymore.
I know.
Essentially, Martha Mitchell was originally encouraged by the Nixon administration to be the unofficial spokesperson for the administration, because as we know, Nixon was horrifically suspicious of the press. The press seemed to like her, so they just kind of have her go and do her thing, and that kind of made everybody happy. Until one day she said, I don't like this Vietnam War nonsense. And everything kind of fell apart after that. And so then they try to hide her in more, but now she's so popular, she's going on SNL. I guess it wouldn't have been SNL, but SNL type thing. She's going on like Rowan and Martin's Laughing as like a guest spot and things like that. We get interviews through the thing with the reporter lady that does her biography that we saw in Gaslit. Mm-hmm. You get interviews from John Dean, Bob Halderman, and the Charlie Brown of the Watergate, Jeb Magruder. Woodward, the reporting guy.
Wow.
You get to have White House tapes between Halderman and Nixon, where you hear them talk about how much Martha Mitchell's being a pain in their ass. Martha actually was an employee of Creep. She had her own office there. She was originally like a public spokesperson for them. She was like a press person until she started talking about the war.
How dare she?
Martha Mitchell was, in fact, on the Maury Povich show, not the one you're thinking of.
There's another one?
There's like a real legitimate news talk show thing.
Where his name is
Nobody Maury. Was like, Martha Mitchell's not on, being like, who's the father?
Wait, but that's a very specific name.
Well, it's the same Maury Povich, just not the show you're thinking.
Okay.
This is a much younger and journalistically integrated Maury Povich.
This is all right.
Before he's just like, well, I need work.
Give me the easy work.
What it drew my attention to was it weirdly, you have like this Nixon's good friend, powerful attorney, John Mitchell. Uh-huh. And so when you're like tapping him for attorney general, you're like, well, that makes sense. He seems to be high profile, well seasoned lawyer guy. But Nixon's like, hey, will you run my campaigns? It's like, what is that? How is that John Mitchell's skill set? Clearly he was good at it. He won twice, but like, I would not think, oh yeah, this guy can run a campaign. I'm like, why? What did you base that on, Nixon? What was the background that he had?
Mm-hmm.
It was only 40 minutes, so it felt weirdly short. It just kind of came and went. But also, I'm not sure if it needed to be longer anyway. So you're like, all right, well, at least you were in and out and didn't overstay your welcome. So the takeaway from it, though, was after watching all this stuff, the similarities between Martha Mitchell and Nixon is that they were both seemingly brilliant people that were held back by their personal demons. And that caused a lot of trouble for them, and that kept them from probably realizing their full potential. Which is kind of crazy to talk about with Nixon because he became president of the United States, but both of them could have had a lot more positive impact on the world if they weren't kind of dragged down by their past. There you go, Watergate Watch. All right, Joe, you want some last looks here?
Oh, I got two things, and then we'll last looks. The budget for this movie was $1.6 million.
Yep, that sounds about right.
The box office was $18.1 million. What a hit!
And I think the most important thing is that this movie still makes money. And I think a lot of producers don't take that into account. Especially you think seasoned producers that have a lot of wiggle room financially because they still have royalties coming in from other successful films. You think they'd be willing to be like, well, this movie might not make a bunch now, but it's going to consistently make money, and improve its returns over the next 5 decades. I know there are a lot of films and they might make a lot now and then they just, everybody forgets about them after 5 years or whatever. Like, what's the advantage of that? Wouldn't you want the passive income all the time and also to be a touchstone film that shapes America landscape afterwards? The cinematic landscape? I don't know. Maybe I'm old fashioned.
Oh, what an idea. And then this is just a follow-up to our podcast about Black Adam. So the box office for this past weekend, Black Adam, oh, I sent this to you already, but I'm just going to read it for the podcast. Black Adam opened to $67 million, which is the best ever solo opening for Dwayne Johnson, which was higher than Shazam, which made $53 million, and matches Aquaman, which was also $67 million. A stronger opening than recent DC branded films like The Suicide Squad, Birds of Prey. I'm going to leave out Wonder Woman 84 because that movie came
that's
out.
That's not fair. Of course you're going to do better than the movie released on HBO Max in a pandemic.
Yeah, that's really cruel to put that on there. Super Pets and Lego Batman.
Lego Batman also feels a weird one to throw in there, but fine.
Yeah, I agree. But it's still a DC thing.
Is that what the box office is these days, where 63 is this kind of wild runaway success?
Oh, like the amount that Black Adam made this past weekend? It's pretty good. I mean, most movies start non-franchise, like beginners or whatever, or like maybe they're a beginning of a franchise. They start at like $30 million now.
Well, right? Isn't that...
That's a big opening for a like smaller movie.
Yeah, but how the times have changed.
I know.
That's wild.
Well, I mean...
The headline says $67 million, $63 million, and I go, oh, that's not really that good. But then apparently it's better comparatively than other films. And I go, wow, what's happened to the cinema?
We're just in different times right now.
Especially since the tickets are way more expensive, too.
Who are they?
And it's still only 63? Like, good Lord.
All right, last looks.
Well, what annoys me is just how much audiences seem to like the movie. I was liking when critics were slamming it.
Ugh.
And it just seems like people are like, yeah, this is good. And I go, what? This is the shrinking doxa, where people are like, yes, this is good. And they're getting mad at people who don't like it. They're like, you're just frou-frou art people. Excuse me? In the world of food, here's how I would describe it. Is I'm like, hey, maybe don't eat a whole bucket of deep fried chicken. And they're like, oh, look at Mr. Fancy Pants over here. With salad, with his vegetables. Oh, didn't know you were too good for America. Jesus. All right, what were you saying, Joe?
What was I saying? Oh, just when I went, my theatrical experience was just like six other dads around my age range. And they were just like, all right, we're here to see the Black Adam movie. And then they quietly left. No noise the entire movie. And I'm like, all right, guys, see you at the next one.
All right, what are your last looks on Five Easy Pieces?
Last looks on Five Easy Pieces. I will tell you, this was 5 easy stars, baby. I loved it.
All right.
So good. I love Jack. Give me yours. Give me those last looks.
Why does Jack Nicholson do this movie? Well, because it's a star maker. Like, I obviously he got a great supporting role in 5 Easy Pieces. Bob Rifelson's also his friend from Head Days and probably beforehand. And so Bob's like, I want you to star in this movie, and it's a really interesting part. And why wouldn't Jack Nicholson take it? I don't know. Makes a total amount of sense. It's a great, juicy role. It's, you know, Jack Nicholson clearly versed in world cinema, so it's a type of movie he probably wanted to make himself, but now he gets to be in it. Mm-hmm. And after this, I think he's this big global star, and we're going to not be surprised by some other movies coming his way.
Hell fucking yeah.
All right, well, I'd like to thank our sponsor, Jig Mac. Get jiggy with it at McDonald's. The Jig Mac. I'd like to thank Lev Van Rensselaer for minding those audio boards and keeping the sound so slippery smooth. And of course, I'd like to thank Joe Vekeman for stopping by.
Oh, thank you.
And I am your host, Patrick Skeyhill. You may find my features, documentaries, short films, video essays, animations, behind-the-scenes footage, and so much more at QuixoticUnited.com and social media, presumably, with a similar-sounding name. Thank you all for listening. Joe, say goodnight.
Good night. Halloween special.
I don't know what that means. It's a lot of letters coming at me.
So it's exactly what it kind of sounds like. It's originally, it says the tagline is the infamous 1987 live broadcast. And it's the description is, originally broadcast live on October 31st, 1987, the WNUF Halloween special is a stunning expose of terrifying supernatural activity that unfolded at the infamous Weber House, the site of ghastly murders. Local television personality Frank Stewart leads a group of paranormal investigators, including Catholic exorcist Father Joseph Matheson and the prolific husband and wife team Lois and Claire Berger. Together, the experts explore the darkest corners of the supposed haunted Weber House, trying to prove the existence of the demonic entities within. Did they find the horrific truth, or simply put superstitious rumors to rest? Okay, now disregard all of that.
None of that happens in the movie.
It's not a movie. It's like if someone recorded from a VHS tape back in 87, the news that aired before, kept all the commercials in, and then recorded this special where they go into a house that's been haunted. I can tell you that I would like you to watch it, and I would... But hold on. It's like 83 minutes. It's not going to cost you a thing. I'm going to send you the link. Because have you heard of this? There are just full movies on internetarchive.com. Have you heard about this?
I have not heard of
this.
You
can just watch full movies.
Well, I mean, this thing doesn't sound like a movie.
Well, my suggestion was just put it on the background and you can catch things. Put it on when you're like doing something.
Your credibility's a bit stretched because of how many stars you gave to Halloween 3.
What did I give?
It was more than one.
It doesn't matter. I gave it 3 stars. No, that is like a lot of people's favorite Halloween movie.
It
kind of blows my mind that it's everyone's like one a lot of people's favorites, because I'm like, guys, I get it's campy, trashy fun, but it's also like not pulse pounding driving. Like there's nothing really to it.
It's one of the dumbest scripts I've ever seen. I guess I've read it, but I can imagine that. I don't know who would greenlight this movie.
Well, it's supposed to do like an anthology horror thing.
Listen, I like the idea. I've always liked the idea, and I was mad they didn't do it. I think that'd be a fun little... If we're going to get 9 hostels in 9 years, why don't we shake it up? But if this is
like
the... If they're like, okay, this is the second thing we're going to try in this anthology, see if it works, and you get this, I don't blame them for being like, nah, we're going to go back to the thing that works.
Yeah, well, because everyone was like, well, where's fucking Michael Myers?
Okay, but I can also just be like, oh, this is really stupid. Why would we do this again?
Well,
they
should have done
the
it as
other
number,
thing, at least.
Yeah, but they should have done it as number 2 instead of doing 1 and 2 being the Michael Myers, Laurie Strode
thing. Would that have helped? Yes, and everybody's just like, well, I hope the third one is good.
Yeah.
But instead...
I don't really like the second one.
Fine, whatever, I don't care, but that then you said have a precedent, but if you have, like, guy killing, seeing his sister naked, and then you've got this stupid Celtic mask company bugs, and then your third one's
that
whatever.
No, it's crazy. It's such a crazy setup.
Stupid.
It's, like, one of the silliest things. But there's also, like, deranged, like, torturing of children, which always gets me, so I'm just like, ah.
Okay. All right.
It's just fucked up with the idea that people would like to put masks on children and have snakes come out of their heads.
It's just everybody, Joe. It's an egalitarian, event.
I think it's a mediocre movie. I don't think it's bad. I don't think it's good. I think it's very mid.
That's where your credibility goes, because it's atrocious.
Oh,
I was
thanks.
Very upset when the art movie theater, they're like, this is our big Halloween movie. And I go, Halloween 3? Damn it!
I told you, it's a huge cult hit.
Yeah, I know.
People love it.
Fine.
I think it's fine.
They can have it.
I watched it, I was like, it's fine.
I don't want it. And that one they set up for a sequel, too, so the whole anthology thing was a mess.
Well, yeah, so just, I'll send that to you. Just put it on the background when you're, like, editing something, and you'll get it, what you're supposed to get out of it.
Fine.
I think it's fun. Very silly. It really makes you feel like you're watching TV, like, in the late 80s, mid-90s.
So our former guest, Lawrence Hewitt, the British guy.
Oh, yeah.
If I may be racist, the British guy. That's all he is.
Okay.
He's learned what the movie Red One is, starring Dwayne Johnson.
Oh, yes. I learned what it is, too.
Oh, well, I won't bring it up.
You can tell me, though.
All right.
No, tell me.
He has described it as or quoted it as, "The project is seen as the first of a potential franchise." Surprise, surprise.
Yes.
reimagining holiday mythology.
Oh, I didn't hear about this.
Mythology. What is the mythology we have here? You know what I think it is? Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Okay, so what I heard was this movie is supposed to help you buy shit from Amazon. It's like they're working in tandem with Amazon Prime. And it's like you're going to be able to see something on screen, be like, hey, I want to put that in my car. And then it goes instantly in your car and you can buy it.
Well, listen, I've been waiting for them to do that for like 10 years, 12 years now. So I'm glad they finally figured this out. Good Lord. I just always assumed this was going to be a way for TV shows to make ancillary money come in and like make use of, I don't know, NBC and CBS used to have things on their website like before there was like Hulu was big. And it their website's pretty basically had nothing else going on. And I'm like, this feels like not a great use of your web space. So I thought like maybe there could be this other, you know, like you could find the set. You'd go to the set of a show and you could like click on a furniture piece or you could click on a prop or something. And then you go to the Amazon, which I'd also recently learned of. I don't know. So I'm glad 12 years later, somebody's finally listened to me screaming into the void.
Well, it was The Rock. Of course he was listening to you.
It was Santa Claus. Yeah, yeah.
Fucking hell. So, well, when you go onto your Amazon Prime, you boot up the Lord of the Rings, and you're like, ah, I want one of those rings from the Lord of the Rings. Ah, I want one of those flea bags from Fleabag.
Do you watch the Lord of the Rings thing? I have no idea what's going on there. I think some people are mad about stuff, but others aren't.
Yeah,
I don't know.
I put it on, and I believe within 15 minutes, I was out like a light. So okay. I use it as a sleep. It'll tell me get to sleep. It's very boring. I used to have
a VHS tape of episodes 4 through 6 of the Digimon cartoon that I used for the same function. Long, long ago.
Well, I'm about to finish up my Spielberg for the year, and I believe that's what War Horse will occupy. A movie that I have had zero interest in.
And then you'll be ready for the semi-autobiographical, whatever it's called.
You brought it up. So, Regal's been doing this Mystery Movie Monday thing. Do you know about this?
Nope.
At all? Okay, so for $5 at 7 o'clock every other Monday, they've been doing Mystery Movie Mondays. And I've come to the conclusion by the rating system and the runtime, this movie has to be The Fablemans. But I think people think it's the new Black Panther movie because they're coming out around the same time. And my theater is almost sold out. So I bought a ticket last night. It was only 50 cents because I had the loyalty pass. I'm hoping it's The Fablemans. If it's Black Panther, I'm just going to go back to my car and drive to work and sleep in my car until I have to go to work. Because I'm going to see Black Panther. I just don't care about seeing it that night. I want to see The Fablemans. I'm very excited.
Okay.
As you know. But Mystery Movie Monday. What a weird concept.
I just like getting what I get. I don't need to be like surprised. Yeah. I've taken the time to do a thing. I want it to go the way I expect.
I know. It's already backfired because I read something the other day where a lot of people were excited when they had the same thing the week before Bros came out. And everyone's like, oh, cool, rated R comedy. We assume it's all going to be Bros. What else could be coming out? And it was the Zac Efron, Peter Farrelly, The Greatest Beer Run Ever movie that played instead.
I have no idea what that is.
That's an Apple TV Plus movie.
Oh, look, you got a free thing, everybody. Who are you complaining? You don't even need Apple TV to watch it. You won.
Yeah, it's...
You scored.
It's just a nothing of a movie, though.
Well, sure they all are, but... Like, you... You don't get to be mad if you went to Mystery Movie Monday and you didn't get the movie. That was, you brought that on yourself. You're not getting mad at the lottery when you don't win it. Like, that's unfair.
I only read it. I wasn't able to go to that one. But I'm excited. I think it's Fableman's. Hey, did we watch a movie this week?
Yeah, we did. I guess we'll talk about that and not the Godzilla movie that's coming back into theaters on November 3rd. That's fine.
Wait, do you want to talk about the Godzilla?
No, we can do the recording. I'm all set and ready to go. Let me just drink from my water.